So the original title was, this was based on the Slim Shady song, because in around April 2000, we've had some massive transformations. It was the same time all the tech stocks crashed, kind of similar to some of the changes we're seeing now. And at the same time, Slim Shady standing up was all about combining pop and rap together, converging of security, converging of different genres, which we hadn't considered before. So what I'll do, let me give you a framework on things that we should look at when we're looking at security, things that are the problem statement, and then I'm gonna give you a mindset of how we have to change as security professionals in order to adapt, because this is now a major transformation we're seeing. So just quick disclaimer that RSA makes me put in. So I jokingly like to say there's two types of people in this world. Can anyone guess? Come on, I want some interaction here. Those who patch and those who don't. We know that's true. I mean, think about the family members you have that don't want to update their software because, oh, it's going to slow me down. Or when we had to deal with Log4j or some of those things, you were just trying to keep track of all the different products out there. Forget about patching. You were just trying to identify first. And then eventually we started. Now, this right here is part of the problem, is we've got to the point where we now buy software and we have to update it ourselves. We've got to make sure it works properly. And the business, as I'll talk to you about later, has this thing about certain rules that they like. Part of it is, don't mess up my business. And so imagine a typical enterprise network, mid-market network, doesn't matter how large, the typical customer you have doesn't just have iPhone and Android, they also have other products in their environment. And now, let's be honest with ourselves. How many of you said, ooh, I want one of those, I want one of those, ooh, I need that, oh, I'm missing this. Yet when we translate that to the business, they're like, why do you want one of those? We don't speak the same language because we're too busy finding shiny objects. In a lot of ways, we're adolescents, we're children. We still want our shiny objects. We want our toys. We'll buy a toy, we'll start playing with it, we'll do what it needs to do, and then later on, as we've seen massive transformation, folks leave, folks change, and a new person comes in, I don't like that toy, I want a different toy. Does that sound familiar? So we've got to kind of start thinking about the constant changes we have now. And I'm sure you've seen this, all these numbers before. How many of us are going to be remote? I mean, most of us, I'm finding out, are not going 100% back in the office. There'll be like 1 or 2 days in the office. Every customer I've talked to says 1 or 2 days. They're slowly easing into it. But I'll tell you what, I've liked being in person. I like being here at this conference because we're allowed to connect. We're allowed to innovate. We're allowed to have conversations that gets us together. So I do think we'll still be remote and still be in the office. Yet at the same time, how many of you see this number of millions of cybersecurity jobs? Or is it 3.5 million? It just keeps going up. And we have more openings. And I actually dug into this data. This was a really interesting statistic. How many of these jobs do you think actually require special certifications? Like a CSSP? Any guesses? Almost 1 million of them. Now the question I said is, do we have enough CSSPs to actually cover? And we only have 700,000 CSSPs. Yet we have 1 million job openings for CSSPs today. So we've basically piled high and deep all this technology, expecting us to hire someone. Yet we've seen people leave. We've seen people say, I want to do something different. You know, what's the definition of insanity? Doing the same thing over and over again, expecting the same result. So what are we doing? We put out more job recs for more technology, yet we've never said, do we have the right technology? We never said, do we have too many, too little? I think the average security company or average has like 76 different security products. That's security products, not including all the other technologies they might have. So I want us to start thinking about how do we actually translate the needs of cybersecurity to the business. Because when you've got this, I almost call it the definition of insanity, expecting this pipeline to be filled, expecting us to find people, we see salaries go up, which is great for us for cybersecurity professionals, but at the same time, that's not economical in the future. We can't prolong that. So most of you have heard of SASE, you've heard of SSE and Gartner. I want to translate this to business a little bit. Most of, just for those of you that are familiar with the SASE mindset, it's about consolidating security and having a platform that's actually, believe it or not, outsourced. You're not managing it, you're not updating it. So when you speak to the business, it's all about risk transfer. They want to transfer the patching to someone else. At the same time, they might say, oh, I'm consolidating vendors, or I might be able to reduce my staff. That's the business outcome. And then the CISO says, hey, align to the business. At the same time, I got more visibility and everything else. Now, I want to point out a couple things in this diagram from Gartner. On the bottom, they point out consistent user experience as the foundation. They also point out the value of identity for device. They point out the value of context. Everything in there are security products. So in essence, they want to make it so you don't have to worry about what's in the box. They want to make it so you can actually just use it with the right context, the right user experience. So one area that I've been really interested in is how do we simplify security to the point where any user can do it? And for those of you that have Pile, Hide, and Deep, you don't need a PhD to use it. It could be anyone that uses it. So then we don't need a CSSP. We just need someone that knows how to use Excel or knows how to use a certain framework. And we can teach them. Because if we keep raising the bar of what we want, we're never going to get it. So you guys have heard of Maslow's hierarchy of need. Some of you remember this? The psychological needs, the safety needs, the love, the esteem. What's really interesting about this is a lot of times we have to start the foundation. We need the psychological side handled before we go up. Now, I started wondering, could I apply something like this to the business? Could I apply something like this to security? And so if we talk about the business side of the hierarchy of needs, rule number one, what's rule number one? Don't mess up my business. That's usually the number one rule for any company. Yet here we are buying technology that blocks, tackles, and does all these things, yet rule number one is don't mess up my business. So when we translate it to the business, we've got to make sure we understand we're not going to break it. Or if we do, we want to first retain key capabilities, specifically core capabilities. How many of you in your employer know what their core capability is? What is their core business? The thing that cannot be messed with at all. You know, when you start thinking of key capabilities, and a lot of times it's things like, I have a payment system. I have a supply chain that I'm, if it's a retail store that's coming in, yet we don't want to mess up the security. I mean, can you imagine if you buy a certain technology, a firewall or antivirus, and all of a sudden the actual registers don't work for a moment in a store globally. All of a sudden they're losing millions of dollars per second. And it's like, oh no, we have to keep you secure. That's what we keep focusing on. Yet we haven't done the right testing. We haven't focused on the key capabilities. And once we focus on the key capabilities, that's when we can start having discussions with the business about what trade-offs do we need to do that we can balance. A lot of CISOs, I'm noticing a trend. There's usually a chief risk officer that's outside the CISO. CISO owns security, chief risk officer owns the balance of do we implement or not implement a lot of that times. And all the ways they're translating to the business. But we don't have enough people, so do I hire a CISO? Do I hire a CRO? Do I hire now a business information security officer? Or can I maybe just get the CISO to be smart enough to actually translate to the business? Some of the best CISOs were not technical that I met, but they were good at actually translating the business need and partnering with the business side of it. And as you go up, you find out that the acceptable trade-offs you do of where do we put security in, is that acceptable to the board? The next piece is, how do I use this? Does it make my secure, is it so secure that it's in a steel box and I can't use it? Or is it something that security is just the guardrails? So when we start thinking about security, we have to make sure we align it back to the business. And of course, once we handle all those, that's when we can actually look at going above and beyond. So these are foundational. And realistically, enhancing capability is once you've handled deficient needs. So if you remember Maslow's hierarchy of needs, a lot of it was you have to go up that triangle. But you can't go to the next level until you've satisfied the lower level. But yet we get stuck in this top right corner, enhanced capability a lot of times. How much AI, how much machine learning do we have that doesn't make us more secure, yet it feels like it's a shiny object? And I'm speaking from experience where I had large networks I had to operate, hundreds of thousands of users, and anytime I tried to get a change in, they didn't care about what technology was in there. They cared about the mission, they cared about the objectives, they cared about the key core capabilities. So let's look at the security mindset, keeping in mind the business there for a second. We put security efficacy first, is that right? Yes, no, come on. And then we say, oh, we want analytics. We want it to be, you know, I want all the gorgeous visualizations, all the AI, the machine learning. And then we'll look at user interface, because I've got AI and MI underneath it. So as I build this up, then I say, oh, do I have all my data connected? Do I have all my connections? So think about it, we put security first, then we put, is it shiny? Then we put the user experience, and then we actually say, can it actually meet my job? Is this right? I'm curious for your thoughts on this. Just shake your head or nod, it works. And then we put identity last. How many of you actually usually put identity last in security? Think about security, SOC, and everything else. They focus on putting all this together and then growing it. So, yet when the business looks at the cybersecurity industry, it doesn't look like a clean triangle. It looks confusing. And then we wonder, why don't we get along? Why can't we speak the same language? Is because they see us like this. They see us where your values are misaligned. Your focuses are the wrong thing. Because in their eyes, the business is looking at things that, you know, are more important. Like they value connectivity and identity far more than do security and analytics. So with that, let me give you a mental mind framework on how to do some of this. So let's go back to the aligning it. So first, we've got to, as practitioners, honestly, grow up. How much of us have that little 5-year-old or 6-year-old that plays with toys and says, ooh, it's got a new buzzword. If I do this, I get another job. But we forget about how do we line this up with security. So one thing we've got to do is start realigning our priorities so it actually focuses on the business instead of us internally. And in order to get away from and actually get ahead of the hiring demands that we need, we've got to start actually embracing simplicity. So that means sometimes you pick a solution that's easier to use, easier to deploy, than something that's got every single bell and whistle. At the same time, if we do that, we can prioritize based on the business. So let me go back to the SASE that Gartner did earlier. So if we do this, we can definitely transfer risk, we can consolidate vendors, we can do staff reduction, and if we focus on the usability side of it, all those products in the middle that are SD-WAN and Secure Services Edge, they're abstracted from you. That's the goal. So you don't have to worry about, is this a VPN? Is this a ZTNA? Is this a firewall? I just need to get access from the left to the right. Left being your entities, your employees, your contractors, your devices, to all of the applications on the right-hand side. But in essence, SASE is in a transformation. And if you talk to Gartner, they'll say it's a 2 to 5 year journey, which I don't know if we can wait 2 to 5 years. If we're at 3.5 million today, I guarantee we'd probably be at 5 or 6 mil by the time that happens. And then we'll wonder, why can't I manage security? That's the dirty little secret we have, is we spend so much time buying technology now we're actually, it's using us to maintain it versus us using it for the original intent. So now if I take those same pillars and just put them in a simple connection, we've got to focus on connectivity first for SASE. We've got to focus on identity as the core of everything. So we can tie that user to that data. I had a CISO once, they were a business CISO, I would say, and they did not care about technology. They didn't care about, is it a WAF, is it a DLP, is it a firewall? They said, I just have two questions, the who and the what. Who is touching what data? And it came down to something so simple, yet we kept focusing on layers of security in between. And then we say, hey, look what I did. And you show this massive diagram of all these network diagrams of data in between and security in between. Yet, she's like, I care about this and this. Is that more secure? I can't tell. We couldn't answer that question because we overcomplicate. We kept focusing on building Lego boxes inside. So as we go up through this, I saw some trends on the floor when I looked at SASE and SSE. There's about two different models out there for SSE. One of them says, give me all your data. Let me be that network layer that brings everything in. It, regardless if it's an endpoint, an unmanaged device, a branch office through SD-WAN of some sort, and then from there, I'll control your access to your data and everything else. But they wanted everything in a central location. In a lot of ways, it's network security. This is one model. It's focused on the network level side of it. Another level, which is kind of interesting, is instead of being centralized management and centralized enforcement, we said, well, what if we take that same concept and we have centralized management, distributed enforcement? So we're not forcing everything through a central location. We're adapting with security, adapting with the business. So if the business has an issue where we've messed something up, we can flip a switch and redirect the traffic. Let me say that again. We don't want all the data in one location, because if what ends up happening is you have availability, connectivity issues long term. Think of all the supply chain issues we've had over the years, last year or two, it feels like. We need something that's consolidating security, but at the same time leverages the endpoints and the connectors you have, so it's in line when you need it and out of line when you need it, well, without losing visibility, without losing control. Because in essence, we could put everything in one location, but if we do that, how many POPs do we have globally? Then we start having latency issues. Then users start complaining. I recently deployed 365, and I did something similar to this, where I was backhauling all the security through our VPN into our headquarters. And from headquarters, back out to 365. How many have done that? And what happens then? Users say, my video's skipping, my audio's skipping. And then you call Microsoft. And what do they tell you? Get rid of the security. Literally, don't backhaul the network. Go direct. So this kind of model does impact some of that connection, some of that business side, that don't mess up my business part of it. Now, so those are the two models I've seen down on the floor when you start looking at SSE and SASE. Now, I never like giving a presentation without giving you guys something to talk about, something to start thinking about. So let me give you like a top five questions. You know, I wanted to do David Letterman, top 10, but let's make it easy. Top five. So first, the business is really going to care about, can I connect my people and my applications together? They don't care about security, they just care about, can I connect it? So if we're looking at SASE or SSE, we've got to focus on that. The next question, going back to that rule number one, don't break my business, is scalability. Can it meet my needs as I grow, specifically? And then from there, do I have all the identity that I can log into? You'll find that not all applications, not all security, have the right identity in a central location. Think about the APIs you have. How many of them actually support Okta, or how many support SSO? If you've got to integrate, those are things you have to consider. And ultimately, it's going to come down to user experience. Is it fast? Is it efficient? Is it intuitive? Something we keep forgetting about. Is it intuitive? And ultimately, when you start looking at the business and selling it to them, you've got to say, what's the value of this? Well, the value would be, I consolidate, I transfer the risk, I reduce the amount of patching I have to do, and I just make security easy again. Now, Gartner says it takes about 3 to 5 years in terms of the transformation to go to SASE and SSE. I had the team put together a small 7-step process that can do it in 3 weeks. So if you guys are interested, there's a quick ebook here and a webinar that walks you guys through it. So this is, now mind you, this is not security focused. This is like, how do I actually deploy SSE from a business mindset? What do I align to the business with? What questions do I ask? How do I start a project to do this? So I know this is not Black Hat, so it's safe, don't worry. So any questions? Thank you. So I want us all to grow up, and this is one way to grow up, is start aligning to the business and stop spending time with our shiny objects. And thank you.